Congratulations, Kim. Hope everybody had a really good week. You know, if I'm up here, you guys are going to know I'm going to tell you about God's love almost every single time, right? So that is the good news of the gospel. And so that's what I'm always going to talk about. And you know, God's design from the very, very beginning has always been to interact with us face to face. His initial design from the very, very beginning was always that we would interact with him on a personal level, right? And, you know, he set that up in the Garden of Eden that, you know, that we would walk with him in the cool of the day, as I said, Adam did, you know, and then we kind of blew that. And then he sets up a covenant with Abraham, and, you know, it says Genesis 18 that the Lord appeared to Abraham near the great trees. Abraham prepared a meal for him, and they sat down and they enjoyed a meal together, Abraham and the Lord. And you know, and that's after the fall, right? And you know, so we've been told in church, oh, God can't do that. He can't, you know, interact with us face to face after the fall. We're not supposed to be able to see his presence, right? And I don't know why we believe that, because there's so much scripture that points the other direction. You know, and then, you know, even Moses, it said the Lord spoke to Moses face to face as one speaks to a friend, you know, and so he wants that interaction. He wants that face to face. And, you know, Jesus was crucified before the foundations of the world. And I think sometimes we don't think of what that means. You know, obviously Jesus was crucified for our sins and for our redemption, but one of the main reasons why Jesus was crucified was to tear the veil in the temple. And there's some real significance there. What that means, that representation of that veil tearing, or that curtain tearing, is that common people like us can now enter into the Holy of Holies and be face to face with God. And that's really significant. And it says that he did that before the foundations of the world. So that's been the plan from the very, very beginning. So then there's, you know, I want to show you guys, you know, John 4, where it says, a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For they are the kind of worshipers that the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must come to him in spirit and truth. And there's two separate things there. We kind of glaze over that spirit and truth thing, but he's talking about two specific states. You know, God is spirit, so we worship him in spirit. We come into the spirit realm with him. And we're allowed to do that now because of Jesus' sacrifice. And Jesus knows every single thing about us. He knows every single piece of our core, every single secret that we've ever had. So we come to him in truth. We open up our hearts to him. We walk up to him in spirit, and then we open our hearts to him in truth. And so he wants us to encounter him on that personal level. He wants that today. That's available for every single one of us. So today as we worship, you guys want to get started? Like, just start into your first song. As we worship, if everybody wants to stand as we start, I want you to think about that. I want you to walk into that spirit realm. And then I want you to just give everything to the Lord. Just open up your heart and reveal everything to him. He loves you so much. Love him back that way, right? And so, Father, we invite you into the sanctuary, Lord. We invite you into our presence. We want to be near you, Father. We want to be face to face, and we want to have that meal with you. We want to worship at your feet, Lord, at your very presence. And so, Father, we just lift up your name today as we begin to worship you, Father. We lift up your name in reverence, Lord. We ask for your presence in Jesus' name. Amen.
Do you see what I see? Do you see what I see? Feet under. He is risen. We are risen with faith.
What a wonderful day to celebrate. What a wonderful day to remember what God has done for us. What a wonderful day to come together to celebrate what God has done for us. This is indeed a happy day. It is indeed a happy day because our sins are forgiven. We are free in the name of Jesus. It is indeed a happy day. Let me read a scripture. This is from the book of Corinthians. I'm reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. From verse 23 onwards. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. That's why many among you are weak and sick, and the number of you have fallen asleep. But if we judged ourselves, we would not come under judgment. Jesus died on the cross, and he died for us. And these passages that I just read, it says, before he went to the mount, before the crucifixion, he called all his disciples, gave the cup and the bread, and requested them to do it, to eat the bread, drink from the cup, so that it will remember what Jesus has done on the cross. This morning, I want you to take a few minutes. Just few, maybe a couple of minutes. Just examine yourself. Come to the presence of God. Think of what Jesus has done for us. And come to him and say, "Lord, wash me. Wash me with your precious blood. Lord, help me to walk towards the cross where you have died for me, so that the blood may flow through me, that I may be washed and be cleansed." When you come to the Lord, come to the presence of God, he washes your sins away forever. He changes your identity. He changes your destiny. He raises all the names that we used to have before. And he gives us a new name that is a child of God. He raises all the shame and guilt. And he gives us honor. And he honors your face because you decide to come to his presence and accept Him as the Lord and Savior. Many of you know my story. I had different names in my life. I lived in shame and guilt. I never knew Jesus. I never understood what Christianity was all about. I followed different religions. I never experienced the love of the Lord. I had different names. But when I came to know the Lord, He changed me. He changed me. I remember the days I spent in the orphanage. Remember the time, and I thought I need to please other people so that I can be accepted. I tried everything I could do so that I would receive some kind of recognition, some kind of acceptance. But when I failed to receive any of those acceptance and recognitions, the Lord was standing there, His hands wide open to receive me as His child. I didn't have a good childhood. You know, many of you know my story. I would actually walk in front of people so they would just look at me. My mother had someone gave her a long cloth, a kind of a gown. She cut that long gown into two, made two shirts, one for me and one for my brother. And that was my new shirt. And I would use it to walk in front of people, somehow thinking they would look at me. They would like me. They would accept me. And we used to have visitors in this orphanage once in a while from different countries. Very rare. When they come, we would go close to them, smile at them, hoping that they would look at me at least once. I would touch the skin and say, "Why your skin is so different than mine? Why your hair is so different than mine? Would you ask me my name? Would you ask me which grade I am? Would you take me when you take the other kids that you're sponsoring? When you take them, can I come with you?" No one actually looked at me. No one cared. No one even bothered. No one even knew that I was there. Except the evenings when the older kids come to pick up kids to abuse them sexually, and then yes, we were there. But when I came to know the Lord changed my heart. The Lord changed my pain. The Lord took away my disappointments. The Lord took away my whole life of tears and pain. He gave me joy so I can sing together and say, "It is a happy day." Because Jesus changed my life on the cross. So Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me." We have a table today. We're going to take part of the table. But remember in your deep heart, part of your heart, that Jesus is willing to change your life. Jesus is willing to change your name. Jesus is willing to change your destiny if you decide. He is willing. Let's close our eyes and pray before we take part of the table. I want you to submit your life to the Lord and say, "Lord, wash me, cleanse me. Lord, let me come close to you. Lord, change my name, change my guilt, change my shame. No one knows what is going on within me. No one knows the pain and the hurt, the wound that I carry. Lord, everyone just look at me from outside, but you see the deepest part of my heart. Heal me. Change me." Let's Let's pray. Father, we come to you. We knowing that you are here with us today. Lord, we want to sing together. This is a happy day. But by knowing that you have changed my life. By knowing, by realizing, you have changed my name. Lord, we thank you for today. Thank you for coming to this world and dying for me on the cross. You stretched your hands, allowed them to nail, not realizing that is for me, that is for all of us. Thank you for coming to this world and giving us a salvation. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us pray once again. Bible says on the day Jesus took the bread and the cup, he blessed it and he said, come, eat from this bread, drink from this cup. Do this in remembrance of me until I come. This shows that we are part of one family. This shows Jesus is not here yet. I mean, he did not come back yet. He is here. His second coming I'm talking about. He died for you and died for us. Let's bless this and pray to you. Father, thank you. Because this bread reminding us of your sacrificial death on the cross. This cup reminds us of the blood that you have shed for us. Bless us, Lord Father God. Give to us so that we may regain our strength in you. In Jesus' name, amen. Please do come forward.
Taking my
part of the bread and the cup together. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Father, thank you for giving us the privilege to be to take part of the cup and the bread and helping us remember that you have died for us and the salvation is free. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Please be seated for a minute before we come to worship. Is there anyone here? I mean, we have got a couple of new friends joining us today. Thank you for coming and joining Victory Fellowship Sunday service. We welcome you to the church. Is there anyone who is celebrating birthday or anniversary in the month of April? Anyone? Birthday? Who else birthday? So we have one birthday. There's a birthday on the back. Okay. Who else celebrating birthdays? Do we have two people celebrating birthday? Oh, there's one. Okay. Three. Well, let's pray together. This is our family. Let's pray together for everyone who is celebrating birthday. We have three. If you are surrounding them, please lay your hands and pray for them. We're going to pray together. All right. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for those who are celebrating birthdays this month of April. We want to bless them. Lord, we bless them in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we pray, Lord Father God, that this year will bring great joy, peace, and health, and all your blessings from heaven, Lord Father God. Give them a fantastic, great year ahead. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Call me by a new name. Come on, just worship with us this morning. Taking my shame in its place, you give me joy. I'll sing that again. Taking my pain, and you call me by a new name.
Jesus, you are all that I need. It's a great confession of our faith. Jesus, you're all. Can we say that? Jesus, you're all that I need. Amen. It's a great confession. Even when it doesn't look like that all the time, we still make that confession. It's from the abundance of the heart. We say, Jesus, you're all I need. Amen. Amen. It's good to see you this morning. Well, half of us are standing and half of us are seated. It's an awkward moment here. It's like, don't sit yet. I was going to have everybody stand back up. We need a little bit of exercise. You know, your watch is counting your steps. So why don't you, if you guys want to make your way around on this side and kind of greet people that you see across the way there and you haven't said hello to for about 4 weeks, you're welcome to do that. Let's just introduce ourselves to one another. Maybe somebody that you don't know really well. Greet them this morning. Amen. Wow, okay. So some of you made lunch plans and plenty of time to do that. Amen. Wow, it's great. I'm sorry. Come on up, Sonia. We're going to go ahead and receive tithe and offering. You didn't know I was serious, did you? I'm going to have Sonia come up. Just pray over the, give a blessing. Give a blessing over the offering today before we give. I'll give you 2 minutes to do that so we can kind of prepare our offerings. I want to do something else really quick, and this is, I've been looking for the right and the appropriate moment to do this, and I realize that there's really not an appropriate moment to do this. And I want to just kind of give a little bit of an update, really brief, to a mission trip that we made to Ethiopia a few weeks ago. And we came back and we were cheering because we had met with the vice president who gave us clearance and security and everything that we needed to build, to continue to build and finish building our school. So if you didn't know this, this is your opportunity to get your offerings out. Yeah, there's our ways to give. And so while you're doing that, I'm going to tell a story. Is that okay? How many like stories? All right. So we came back, and or I came back, and we had a team there that really was kind of preparing the ground and getting everything ready for the building. And we got a call from the security department, and we were called in. I was here, and the team was there. And one of the guys, if you've ever been to an area that you can give now, and we'll just bless it, you know, when it's away from your hand. It's all right. We'll do it all together. So I got to focus here. So we came back and we got a call from the municipalities department. Everybody knows who that department is locally. It's very similar there. And there was a person in a tribe, and it's actually the tribe that we're helping the most, who receives the most benefit, who would have received the most benefit from the school that we would have built. And what happened is they pulled a really quick, underhanded, manipulative, and deceitful stunt, because they doctored some documents, took them before a federal judge, got a hearing before a federal judge in Ethiopia, and the property was awarded to a person who lives in the area here. He was there at the time. And so when the municipalities and the security called us in, they said, the reason I wanted to talk to you is because this is fraud, it's lies and deceits, is how this was awarded to them. And so what you can do is you can appeal to the president. And the president will give this property back to you because of the documents you had, but you need to understand there will be bloodshed. All these people, the three people that were involved going before the judge, will be thrown into a federal prison and serve extended time. And the tribe basically will be split. In tribes, the way tribes work is there's intermarrying in the tribe. And so anybody that's on one side in a dispute, it just divides that whole thing. It's kind of like a divorce in America. It just kind of divides everyone who's knit together. And so we weighed that carefully and we prayed about it, and we decided that the best thing to do was not to do that, to do what we were advised if we wanted to keep the property. And so what we did is we didn't do anything. We just allowed it to for them to continue on, and they will do with it whatever they see fit to do with it. But we have lost that property basically. And I wanted to tell you that because a few weeks ago, how many was here when I showed all the beautiful pictures of the beautiful wall that we had and getting ready to build? And we were really excited about that. But this is kind of a setback. It doesn't change anything about the main focus of the ministry there in Gambela and Ethiopia and South Sudan, which is on the children. And that's our main focus. We have a number of sponsors of children here. All of that will continue. And when you take into account the number of children that we have direct sponsorship over, the number of children in the homes that they are in that we take care of with food and with education, there's about 100 plus children that all sum total is taken care of, who otherwise would not have a place to sleep, good food to eat, and a good education. And so all of that stays intact, and none of that changes. But I really felt responsible to let the congregation know, because you're the primary supporters of the project there in Africa. We'll be going back in the fall. And we need to pray for those that are our distractors and those that use fraud and lies to win support and that kind of thing. So, yeah, you can pray about that. And there's people that have been closely connected, Yaron is one of them, closely connected to that, who have said to me prophetically, they have said, this is not over. And you know, I can't disagree with that. It's like, I don't think it's over either. And it's so fun because, I mean, that's terrible. But on the other side, the vice president pulled our guys back in and said, we will give you property for free, and we will plot out larger pieces of property if you want to continue the projects that you're doing. And so, yeah, and we don't know yet. We're still praying through all of that. But we just know that the primary thing that we're there for is for the children. And so we're continuing to do that. So is that all right? Any questions about that? This is interactive. Did you know that? All right. All right. How many's finished giving by that time? Not. We're not. All right. So let's stand one more time today. I promise. No, I don't promise. I started to say we won't stand anymore and sit back down, but, you know, that's no guarantees. This is primarily so we can kind of get up to the front. And Sonia, come on up and bless the offering this morning. Anything else? This is a lady who's written a lot on kingdom finance. So just bless us.
Thank you, Father. We bless every offering that was made today, in the past, and coming forth in the future. We thank you, Father, that your offerings will open doors of opportunity, will increase finances for your kingdom purposes, and break curses that the enemy has put on the financial house, Father God. We break those curses now in the name of Yeshua, and we release your blessing, and we release more, the more, the more, the more, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. That's a good word. Everybody say more. All right. If you've not brought your offerings up yet, you're late. Get them up here. Yeah, well, I appreciate the enthusiasm to give this morning. Everybody's just like, oh, we're standing. Opportunity is right. Amen. How many was here last week and you got some of these cards and you started passing those out to five of your friends? How many have five friends or family? How many have 10? At least 10. Guys, we have to make some friends. Nobody is raising their hand, Brian. You got 10? Can we borrow a few from you? Because we don't have any, apparently. It's like, yeah, these cards, we have a few more. You don't necessarily need these cards to invite your friends for next week's service. We have a great service planned out. Sabrina is, we're going to start next week with a great breakfast. There's going to be, how many was here last week? You remember the breakfast we had? Great sweets, right? Lots of sweet stuff. It's going to be up there. We're just going to have a time of fellowship as we come together at 10 o'clock. And then Sabrina is going to start with her dance team and bring a dance. We're going to have some worship. We're going to have a great message and give people an opportunity to get saved, meet the Lord Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. Yahoo! Yeah? And it's going to be a fun day. Then there's all kinds of activities for the children. We're having a baptism service next Sunday. We have 3 people that are already signed up to be baptized next Sunday. It's like, let's see. Baptism is death, burial, and resurrection. How appropriate to have that on Easter Sunday morning, right? And so if you have someone you know, or maybe you haven't been baptized, you'd like to be baptized, my grandchild says, I need to be baptized every week. Is that possible? I said, well, you might need it every week. It's like, so... seriously, we're going to have the baptism tank. So if you've not been baptized, see me after the service. If you want to be baptized next week, it's going to be a fun day. That's all right. Yeah. Okay, so we're going to get our Bibles this morning, and I'd like for you to turn to Matthew chapter 21. Last Sunday and today, last night I was just praying for the service, and the Lord gave me a picture. It was last Sunday, and we never did really get to it last Sunday, and I was reminded about it last week, and the picture was of a roundabout, kind of on a cityscape and the roundabouts. How many like roundabouts? I would rather have a roundabout than a stoplight. I don't know about you guys. I think we ought to do away with stoplights, put roundabouts everywhere, and be done with these, right? Double? Okay, never been to that one. That would be confusing. So the picture that I had was people on a roundabout, and they were stuck. Now, that would be the worst. I guess the key is to get on the outside of the roundabout in time for you to make your exit. And that people are on a roundabout, and they're just doing this. And so I really felt like that was for some of us that were here. And that if your life is, you feel like you're just kind of on this roundabout and you can't find a exit, a way to get off of that going around in circles, that God wanted you to know that he's making a way for you today. And amen. You ever been stuck like that? You feel like, I need direction. I need, does that resonate with anybody this morning? Okay, all right, good. We're gonna pray on that. I want to talk about the triumphant entry of Jesus. Judy came in this morning and talked about palms. Do we have palms? We don't have palm branches to wave this morning. You disappointed? You shouldn't be disappointed. Carolyn warned you last week. We wouldn't have palms. But Judy was talking about bringing our palms and lifting them up before the Lord. Thank you, Judy. That was a perfect picture for us. So we all have palms. Did you bring your palms this morning? We're going to lift our palms before the Lord. There you are, Judy, back there. And so that's the triumphant entry of Jesus. So let me read this section of Scripture. It's Matthew 21. If you have your phones, your iPads, or old school Bibles. All right. Verse 1. When they had come near Jerusalem and reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent his two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say to them, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them and sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and other cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." I have to shake my hand when I do that. "Hosanna in the highest heaven." And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" And the crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus of Nazareth in Galilee." Amen. Great section of Scripture. Amen. So I want you to think about filling in a gap. I'm going to give you a phrase, and it's going to have a blank in it, and I want you to fill in the blank, but I want you to think about it before you holler out what the blank would be for you, okay? Here's the phrase. Is, "The times we live in, they are blank." The times we live in, they are blank. Now, probably all of us have filled in the blank already in our mind at some point in time in the recent past. When you look at the global trends and things that are going on globally, things that are going on nationally, or maybe you're thinking about something that someone else said to you. These times are what kind of times? All right? How many have thought about a word to fill in that? Or maybe a couple of words, all right? So let's hear this section over here. What word would you fill in the blank of "the times we live in, they are changing, exciting"? What? Unprecedented. I would expect that from you, Linda. Anybody else? Tumultuous. Did I hear sad? Okay. You had your hand ready? Treacherous. What about here in this section? What? Times we live in, they are Nicole. Exciting. Just trying to figure that one out. So I'm a little slow this morning, Judy. Ripe with promise. Anybody else here? Hopeful. Awesome. Under God's control. Sad. Evil. Did I hear scary? Evil. Sorry, this section, you had your time. Sorry. And Linda. Have been foretold. Biblical. Wow, these are really good. Anybody else? Ripe for harvest. I like that one. Say it again. Omnipresent. Good. Good. Isn't it interesting? Interesting. Such an array of kind of voices and opinions and thoughts and ideas. Some say scary and some say treacherous and some say exciting and unprecedented. It's like we have this vast thought about the times that we're living in. And when you think about the world and its condition and the rumors of war, and you think about the local condition, the storms, the unpredictability of, just our neighborhoods being destroyed overnight, or the shooting in schools, the shooting recently in a Christian school in the United States, and just other things that are going on. It's like you look at those things and you can't help but stop and really take notice and think about those things deeply. And it's really a good thing for us to do that. And yeah, one more. That's the part, yeah, thank you. That's the part of just this rumors of war that's we're hearing more and more about. And so when times are difficult or challenging or dark, the world tends to think, I won't say we as believers, but the world tends to think more negatively. They don't really think about, oh, these are biblical times. And so it's kind of a snowball effect. It's just like these kind of negative thoughts and negative ideas begin to roll. And it's really not unlike biblical times that Jesus was alive in, and the thoughts of people that were Jews in Israel, Jews that were in Jerusalem at the time that Jesus came in riding on a donkey. And the people, one of the reasons that they were cheering and shouting is because they heard rumors about Jesus all throughout the 3 years of his ministry throughout Galilee. They heard these rumors, or they were firsthand eyewitnesses to Jesus' miracles. And could it be that this would be the Messiah? And if it is the Messiah, that he is here surely to topple the political system that is in rule in Jerusalem and in all of Israel, and to establish his throne and establish his kingdom in Jerusalem this day. Could it be this day? And so that prompted a response by the people. And the prompting of the response was to worship him, to give him praise, to take palm branches, which is a sign of victory, and to lay it before him and say, come into your kingdom, O King, and establish your rule on the earth today, if not yesterday. And it's like, oh, yes. And it's so interesting because when we look at this story unfold during this Passion Week that's just ahead of us, this day, on this day, we celebrate the laying of the palm branches and celebrating the King here to take victory over the political system of our world and to establish his kingdom on the earth and to bring heaven to earth. And then 5 days later, some of the same crowd was in the crowd that was hearing cheers to say, crucify him, away with him. They might have participated in both. We don't know that for sure. But it was the same time period. It's like on one day they were cheering, yay, Jesus! And on another day they were railing and saying, crucify him. And that was such a dichotomy of just atmospheres that was present in the city of Jerusalem in 5 days. 5 days, the radical change that happened with the people. If we can learn to live worship, not just do worship, these days can become some of the greatest days on the earth. So let's talk about worship for a little bit. And there are people around here who are great worshipers. Where did you learn? Now, this is, you don't have to tell me your response here. But where did you learn worship? Where did you, I wish you wouldn't have said that so loud. Where did you learn to worship? Yeah, it's kind of an interesting question, isn't it? Where did you learn to worship? If somebody, I've thought about this, I've thought about it for years. I learned about worship and what worship was, and I learned worship in two specific events, mostly. I've attended a great conferences. You know, you go to worship conferences and they have great worship. You have great lights and great smoke and great, you know, musicians and great songs and new words and all of that. And that's a part of worship, right? We don't discount those things. But I really didn't learn about worship at worship conferences. Isn't that funny? The greatest experience to learn about worship happened in 2010 on my first visit to a refugee camp. And on that visit, first time I've been in refugee camp since that time several times, but we go into this refugee camp in 2010, a small group, take about a 4-hour ride, and then our truck breaks down that we rode in that was scary. That wasn't what I learned about worship. But so I walk into the refugee camp, and these kids, most of the kids there were scantily dressed, barefooted. The paths that they marched on and walked on were beaten down dirt, mud. Many of the kids had infections, infected lice, you know, in their head. I mean, just look at these children and you think, oh, these kids need help right away. They need help. And then you meet some of the leaders and some of the adults in this camp that were eking out a living by going into the bush around them and cutting down wood and burning the wood to make charcoal to put into sacks and then to sell those sacks alongside the road for a few, what is the currency there, burr, a few burr to make a living, you know, to go outside of the camp and buy some food. They would have rice delivered monthly. They would always have oil and rice. That was the staple. They would sometimes have maize or corn that was delivered that they would put into a hewn out stone and take another big pole, and they would grind the grain in that. You've been there. You've seen that. I think I have a picture of you doing that. And they would pound the grain to make meal and to prepare food with that. And usually they said that the distribution of food by the UNHCR would last about 20 of the 30 days in a month. And then for the remaining 10 days, Dottie, you've been there too, the remaining 10 days they would fast. What do you do for the other 10 days? We fast. And they were smiling, we fast. We get to fast because we don't have food. Some of them did, not all of them. Now, and then you go from that point, so you get to kind of the tour. How many's with me in your imagination? Okay. You get that tour, you go around the camp and you meet the elders and you meet the people, you meet the children, you love the children, you just hold the babies and you just do all this stuff. And then you go into this mud hut, long hut that is made for church, for services. And the benches are, they pile up the mud and they pat it down and they dry it out, and that's where you sit on Sunday for worship. Sit down. Everything's made of mud and dung and straw on the roofs. And they'd have these little windows for light to peer in because there was no electricity. And they would worship. They would sing. When you go into the grounds of the church, they would greet you with smiles and cheers and laughter and playfulness, and they would want to know you. What you were talking about, children would want to touch your white skin because it's different. I learned more about worship by visiting a refugee camp than by anything else. Because worship isn't about how I'm blessed. Worship is not about what I have, what I don't have. There's one point to worship, and that is God is God. He alone deserves worship. Whether I have much or whether I have much need, he deserves worship. Most of our pronouns in America that deal in our worship songs are the pronouns of I and you and us. The worship that happens around the throne of God has no I, no us, and no me. Worship is him. The second place that I learned about worship was a friend that I had for a short period of time. He was a Catholic priest in Omaha. I know. All the oxygen got sucked out of the room. You have a friend who's a Catholic. He's not in the area anymore, so. But at the time, he was a great man of God, and he was an intern. Several years ago, he interned with Mother Teresa. Mother Teresa was still in Calcutta, India, and he would go over. He went over there and he interned for a couple of years with her. And he told about a story that really impacted me. He said that one day that they were walking in Calcutta in the area where they did a lot of their ministry and a lot of their work with lepers. And there was this long line for the food. And this long line was to get food, to eat, and then to go in for mass or worship. And Mother Teresa and this group was huddled around Mother Teresa, and they were talking and they were visiting and they were, you know, just wanting to be close to this, you know, person that embodied the nature of Jesus, you know. And so Mother Teresa stopped, and she recognized somebody in the line that was ill, and he was on his, you know, crutches and down, and he couldn't get up to move forward in line. And she stopped, and she went over to this man, and she bent over, and she blessed him, and then she bent over, and she kissed him on the head. This is a leper. He said she kissed him on the head and then came back to the group, and they went on and they said, Mother Teresa, don't you understand what you're doing? This is a leper, like she wouldn't know. This is a leper. And she stopped them and she said, wait, don't you know that this is my Lord? It's amazing truth statement. It's a truth bomb, isn't it? Because Jesus himself said, when you do it to the least of these, my brother, you do it to me. And that's what she was embodying. Sorry for getting emotional right there. Every time I tell that story, I get emotional. It's just so not like me to get emotional either. It's like... But we learned so much about what worship is. I do, from those two huge lessons in my life. The lesson of that is worship is not lived out as a worship that is not lived out as a lifestyle does not meet the biblical definition of worship. Can I say that again? Worship that is not lived out as a lifestyle is not biblical worship. Yeah, it's important that we worship when we come together, you know, in the house of God, right? We worship God. But primarily, that is not worship, our primary way of worship. The primary way of worship is that we take what we embody in the person of Jesus Christ, and we live it out to the people that we walk among, that we work among, and that we live among. Amen. And I know that's probably a little bit different for us to hear in our Pentecostal, you know, way of thinking, is like we come, we dance, you know, loving the Lord with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. What does it mean to love the Lord with all of your strength? To worship the Lord with all, well, that's a good dance service, right? Yeah. In our Western culture, we might think that worship is what we do on Sunday. I'm going to worship. I'm going to worship because it's been a good week. I've been really blessed. We might sing some songs about how the Lord has blessed me, and I can sing and I can shout because the Lord has blessed me. You guys know where this is going, don't you? You feel it, don't you? See, I'm not really good. I have to remind myself all the time what worship is. That worship is being among people and loving them like Christ would love them. Core biblical worship is worthiness of God, period. Around the throne room, here's what you hear day and night. You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory, honor, and power, for you created all things, and by you were they were created. Amen. So Matthew said in, Jesus said in Matthew, recorded in Matthew 15, it says, the people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me. That's kind of provoking, isn't it? The people worship me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Their worship, therefore, their worship is in vain. It means, what does it mean? Could it mean that we could worship God with our mouth and we can think when we leave a place of worship, wow, we did it good. But when we enter into life that we're really not worshiping him as a lifestyle, and it becomes vain worship because Jesus is not at the heart of our life and our worship in life. Distracted worshipers are not people who are checking their Facebook during their worship service. Everybody who's checking their Facebook right now during this worship service, it's like you're off the hook. That's what does you. Now, if Jesus had Facebook, he wouldn't have said distracted worship is worshipers who are checking their Facebook during worship service. He probably wouldn't have said that based on this scripture. Distracted worshipers are those who are disconnecting what they say and what they sing with their lips from their heart that is not engaged in living a lifestyle of worshiping Jesus. You can say amen anytime you want. So we do that primarily by living out Jesus' definition. Here's that Jesus' definition of worship. You want to know what worship is? Loving the Lord your God. You all know this. With all of your heart, with all of your mind, with all of your soul, and with all of your strength, and loving your neighbor as yourself. I have to continually remind myself of that. Worshiping God with all of my strength. What does it mean? Worshiping God with all of my mind. What does it mean? Loving God with all of my heart and my soul. It means when I give my life to my wife, I'm worshiping God. Goes the other way around too. You didn't know that, did you? Did you know that? When I give 40 hours of hard work for pay that I receive for that work, I'm worshiping God. You didn't know that? When I give my money to pay my debts that I have in my life, I am. Don't you know that's right? When I share my resources, I am worshiping God. When I make my enemy my friend, I am. When I become all things to all people, I am. When I do justice and I love mercy, I am. Do you know what Micah said was the disconnect of Israel's worship? Micah 4, he said the disconnect of people's worship is they would lift their hands, they would worship him, just like on the day the triumphant entry of Jesus. They would hail him as king one day, but they disconnected worship from doing justice and loving mercy. And he rebuked him for that, and he judged them for that. Whenever you heard, the last time you've heard someone talk about justice, loving justice, as worship, it's as much worship as anything else. When we do justice, actually, is what it says. So John gets really down where we live in 1 John 4:20 when he says this. He says, those who say they love God and hate their brothers and sisters are liars. Well, that's uncomfortable. It's like, so it gets to the point. Worship is not here primarily. Worship is here primarily. It comes from our heart by loving justice, by doing justice and loving mercy. Amen? Worship is the place where everyone's hearts gets rewired. And they get rewired to the heart of Jesus. When Jesus stands up, people fall down. Have you noticed that? You've been in any place where people fall? Somebody said, why do people fall? It's because they can't stand. If you didn't know that. And Jesus just shows up and it's over for people. And when that happens, it can happen in a worship service like this where we just kind of get knocked sideways, but our hearts get wired. But it can also happen in a refugee camp where our hearts get rewired. It can also happen with a story that we hear, like the one about Mother Teresa, where our heart, because Jesus in worship, what happens in worship is Jesus encounters us. And it's really not worship until Jesus encounters us. And our hearts gets rewired, and we become a different person in front of people who are enemies, and people who don't like us, and people who don't care about us, or our neighbors who have needs, or our friends who have needs. Amen. You guys doing okay? A little quiet in this place, not expecting what you're expecting in a Pentecostal service, huh? Is this all right? So let's look at it in the life of Jesus, in Jesus' ministry when he was getting ready to launch his ministry in Luke chapter 4. So Jesus is in the middle of a worship service. It's the inauguration of his ministry. And he stands up and he quotes from the prophet Isaiah, and he says this. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Yahoo. Right? Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And that's when you want to yet out of Yahoo or yay man, whatever your, you know, whatever your expression is. We had that young man here a couple of weeks ago. He was a Yahoo guy. I love that. We need more Yahoo guys here today. It's like, Spirit of the Lord is upon me. I'm anointed. I feel the anointing in this place. Have you ever heard that in a good Pentecostal service? What does it look like? He says, he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor, to proclaim release of the captives and recovery of the sight to the blind. Let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. That's the worship. To undo the bands of those that are in bondage to sin. Amen. To see them go free. To care for the marginalized, the poor, those who are without. As much of worship as anything else. A lot of times I have conversations with people after service or during the week, and they come up to me and they talk about their spouse. And they say, I'm really concerned because in worship service I don't see my spouse raise their hands. It's usually a wife talking about the husband. It wasn't you, Pat. And it's like, wait a minute. You know, I really never ask these kinds of questions, but you could just kind of ask questions. Just, do they love you? Yeah, they love me. Are they honest? Do they have integrity? Do they give an honest day of work for their wages? Those are the questions. It's just like, yeah, they do. It's like, all right. So if we're not raising our hands in Sunday morning during worship service, Is that everything? Or shouldn't it be only part of it? Now, all of you guys that fit that category, you should come up to me after service and shake my hand and thank me for saying that right there, right? So don't get concerned. Here's when you get concerned. Is what John said, what Jesus is talking about, is like, how aware are we of the marginalized people around us on a daily basis? That's worship. And that's more profound, I would say, based on the scriptures of Micah and Isaiah and Jesus' ministry, probably more profound or as profound as people who lift their palms before the Lord on Sunday morning. Because how many knows we can lift our palms and lift our voice on Sunday morning and just be empty words, because it means nothing Monday through Friday. Amen. Need me to say that again? I can plow that ground. I love to dance. Now, don't get me wrong. I love to dance. I love to raise my hands. I love to jump. If I'm here or I'm visiting someplace else, and there's a really good song, I'm probably going to be jumping. I don't dance well. My wife will tell you that. But I will jump. So I'm a jumper. I'm a jumper. All right? But if you don't jump, but your life, your heart is filled with worship of God, awe of God, and your life has been rewired by being in the Lord's presence, it's really cool. It's really a good thing. Amen. My screen went blank. All right. So what is the Lord's will is? I know he's taken people with him, and they've all done that at places, and he's probably more influential in that area than other areas, you know, as far as influencing people with the gospel of Jesus Christ, being Jesus to them, ministering to them, praying for them. How many do that, by the way? You're just good tippers. My wife is the best tipper. So encountering God, worship is, I'm landing the plane. Real worship encounters God in the simple or in the complex. Worship will take you to a place of encounter. Encountering God redefines everything called normal and commands us to seek his kingdom first in our life. It's not comfortable. Real worship is not always comfortable. It's sometimes frightening. Would you agree? That's why over and over again when Jesus shows up, or God shows up, or his angels show up, the first words out of their mouth is, fear not. Because I'm about to get afraid when God encounters hearts. God will not fit into any of our boxes. I would put a triple exclamation point behind that statement. He refuses to fit into boxes. He refuses to fit into the ordinary. And aren't you glad? God is, and he will be God. He knows it. And the most dangerous thing you will ever do in your life is to encounter God, because it's transformative. Transforms your heart, it transforms your life, transforms everything that you do and everything that you say. If your life hasn't been wired by an encounter with God that touches the world, it's like you need to get alone space and say, God, I need to encounter you more than anything else. If you're obsessed with safety, routine, it's absolutely essential that you encounter God. Pretty exciting. Scary? How many are scared? We're going to have an altar call for those who are scared and in fear. It's like, what are you talking about? It's like, how many knows what I'm talking about? You get before the Lord, and he encounters you, and you're scared to death. 2004, I was in the sound booth on a Saturday evening service, in a worship time, and Jesus encountered my heart. In fact, eight couples on the elder team, those that were here were on our face right around here in the front because Jesus encountered us during a time of worship, and we were scared. We were scared. Because what Jesus was saying to us is like you've built programs, you've built buildings, and you built things, but I am not here. Now, the reason he said that is because the person with the microphone opened up for Jesus to be able to encounter us, to be truthful. And so what we did in 2004 and 2005 is we dismantled all of our programs. You know why we dismantled all of our programs? Because we were scared. That's why we did it. You remember that time, Vi? And I remember hearing from the Lord so loudly when he said, I was sitting right there where Brian's at on a Monday morning, because the Lord said, I don't want you to study for messages and prepare slick PowerPoint presentation, although there's nothing wrong with those. But I was like, well, what am I supposed to do if I'm not preparing for Sunday worship? Well, maybe worship me. So I obeyed because I was to death. I thought, this is the end of me. And so I heard the Lord say, Jeremiah 50. Some of you know this story. Jeremiah 50. I never read Jeremiah 50 to my knowledge. I'm sure I did. You know how you pass through those prophets? Jeremiah 50 says this. It's branded on my brain. My shepherds have led my sheep from mountain to hill, and they've forgotten the place of my rest. So I felt this finger in my chest when I read that. Not my finger, I felt the hip finger. It's a floor right there. That was where I parked. Because God was saying to me, you're the shepherd who's led the people from mountain to hill and forgotten the place of rest. And so on Friday of that week, I asked the Lord everything in those days. I didn't presume anything. And I said, Lord, what am I supposed to talk about on Sunday? I haven't prepared a message to preach kind of like this. I've got notes. And he said, you know what he said, right? Jeremiah 50. I was like, please, no, anything but Jeremiah 50. And he said, Jeremiah 50. I said, okay. So the message that morning was 10 minutes long. The reason it was 10 minutes is because it's all I said. Now, I thought this has got to be the most humiliating thing that will ever happen in my ministry, for me to stand up and repent to the congregation for being a shepherd who's led sheep from mountain to hill and taking them away from God's rest instead of to God's rest. But I'm telling you, so what happened, instead of being humiliated, I was humiliated. Stood right there and I said, we're going to open to Jeremiah 50. I read the text and I said, the Lord has provoked me this week and he's told me I am that shepherd in Jeremiah 50. This is hard to do. It's really still hard to think about. And I closed my eyes because I was scared, because I thought, here's what I deserve. It's like, and what happened when I closed my eyes, I prayed this short prayer of forgiveness. I asked forgiveness to the congregation. I said, forgive me, Lord. I closed my eyes and I kept them closed because I was afraid to open them and I didn't know what to do next. And there was a little boy in the congregation by the name of Michael, and he was standing right here, and he repented like a minute or two after I stopped praying. He repented And I still had my eyes closed, and I heard him say, "Forgive me for being disobedient to parents." Da 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 da. I kept my eyes closed, and a person over here, a man, man's voice, repented, and then it was like popcorn from then on. And it was like when I opened my eyes, I realized during the time that I had closed my eyes and out of sheer fear, because I didn't know what to do, that everybody had come to the front and like they were repenting of sins in their life. And what I had thought would happen is if I confessed my sin before the people, that I would be humiliated and the people would not respect me anymore. What actually happened when I repented for my sin, it gave permission for people to confess their sin, to remove the veil, and to say, "This is not who I am when I just show up on Sunday morning. This is who I am. I can be real here. Be me." Amen. Yeah, that was scary, but I'm telling you, it was the most dramatic encounter that I've had in my life personally in a place of worship with Jesus. How many of you here during that time, you remember those times? How many want to go back to those times? No, no, Lord. No, well, keep me in the place of humility to do justice and love mercy. That's where I want to live. Amen? So let's stand together. I'm going to have the worship team come. I took my liberty this morning just to kind of unload that, because more than anything else, I want us to be a church, a congregation of people who love God, who's trusting the Lord as we move forward in Him, that we're not afraid of change. Everybody say that really nice and loud. I'm not afraid of change. I'm not stuck in the past. And I love encountering Jesus. Get ready for a wild ride. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So, Lord, we're trusting you with our life. We're trusting you, Lord, with our reputations. Oh, yeah. We've got so much to hold on to, who I am and my reputation, my respect, and what I feel is respectable and what I feel is disrespectful. Lord, in my own Western theological mind, Lord, break the shell of religion and what I feel like is comfortable. Break it, Lord, off of my life and take me to zones and areas where it's very uncomfortable to be in that place, to learn from you and to see you move. But God, guide our steps for people around us, where we live, where we work. Lord, I pray that you would rewire our minds and our brains to kingdom thoughts, kingdom ways, not our own Western ways. Help us to connect worship with justice, worship with mercy, worship with kindness, worship with loving our neighbor as we love ourselves. In Jesus' name. We're going to have a couple prayer teams come up. We got a prayer team in the back there also, Dennis and Beneve, if you're available. And just to get ministered to and prayed for today. This is very uncomfortable. It's probably as uncomfortable for me as it is you, maybe, to tell some of these stories and be real in front of you. But Jesus often was uncomfortable with people, brought people put to the place of their being uncomfortable, and then he liberated them. He set them free. And I want you to be free today. This is a church that is called to be multi-generational, called to be multi-ethnic. And if we're going to do that, we have to take the veils off and trust Jesus with our life. So if you need an encounter with the Lord today, I'm going to invite you to go to one of these prayer teams this morning. I know. You say, what? After you just said what you said. No, go ahead. Take the first step. It's going to be all right. Also, if you're on that, what is that thing again? Where you go around and around and you need a place to get off. So I'm telling you, the Lord told me that he's going to give you an exit in this, an exit strategy to get out of that cycle that you've been in your life. So let's worship. If you're not answering a call for prayer today, let's just enter into a place of worship. Just focus your mind's eye on the Lord, the throne room of God, and let's just worship him this morning. Thank you. don't want to distract anyone that's worshiping this morning. But there were several people that raised their hands that wanted prayer because you just felt like you were on that roundabout. It's like, just raise your hand. If you raised your hands before, just raise your hands again. And let's identify those that are around us. Just keep them up. Let's just look around. And let's just pray for those that are raising their hands this morning. Keep your hands up. Amen. Can we just move around kind of where they're at? Let's just pray. Thank you. for that this morning, guys. Amen. Lord, we thank you. Thank you for what you're doing among us, through us, Lord, to the world around us. Thank you for the blessings, the benefits that you've given us in our lives. I just want to speak. You know what a benediction is, right? Benediction. It's two words. One is dictionary. Diction. We get our word dictionary. It's many words. The other one is bene, which is benefits. Many benefits. So I just speak the Lord's blessing and favor over your life. That your vision from this day forward would not be small, but would be expanded to see the same way and the same thing that Jesus sees. Not that we're living in a world that is full of scariness, maybe dark, but what opportunities we see because of the benefits that you provided for us on the cross. So Lord, we take the benefits, the many benefits that we have that's been imparted to us freely. And the more we give, the more we receive. So we're givers, we're dispensers of grace and mercy and justice and love from the kingdom into the world around us in which we live. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you guys. Stay in worship as long as you want, as long as the worship leaders hold out.